son of the prophet.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, your presence fills the universe. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, guide us home with you into bright glory. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Thank you.
The 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain to which Jesus had ordered them. When they saw him, they worshipped, but they doubted. Then Jesus approached and said to them, "All power in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. And behold, I am with you always, until the end of the age." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Today we celebrate that Jesus returned to the Father and now sits at his right hand. Now you might ask yourself, so what? What possible relevance could that have to my life right now? I hope to be able to answer that question by the end of this. There is a heresy that has been going around for a long time called dualism. We know that right now as human beings, we have a body and a soul. What dualism says is that our spiritual souls are good, but our physical bodies, and in fact the physical world, is bad. That the spirit world is the only realm that is important, and the physical world is bad because that's where sin and death live. The goal of life, then, is to escape the prison of our bodies so that we can live forever in the purely spiritual world. One form of dualism that most of us know at least something about is the Puritan movement, which was in the mix of people that settled the New World. But dualism has tried to creep several times over the centuries into the Christian world. And when it does, it affects how Christians look at things such as their sexuality. Under this way of seeing things, sex is bad because it is so closely tied with the creation of new human beings with physical bodies, and because the sexual pull is so strong in people that we must be suspicious of so strong a force. So, we tolerate sex because it's the vehicle through which new life comes, but it is always suspect and associated with sin, even within marriage. Another area that dualism has sometimes crept in Christianity is in our notion of death. As I said before, dualism wants us to believe that death is the welcome escape of the spirit, which goes to heaven, and the body, which decays in the ground of nothing. Someday, at the end of time, says dualism, God will do away with all that is physical, annihilating the universe that we know, so that only the spiritual will remain into eternity. In case you haven't figured it out, this is not what Catholicism says at all. And we can verify this by hearing what the Church has to say about the Ascension. If dualism were true, one would expect that Jesus would shed, get rid of his humanity on his way back into the Trinity, right? Wouldn't that make sense? Well, in fact, the Church proclaims that Jesus returned to the Father with his humanity intact. Now, Jesus was both human and divine, not half and half, but fully both. And that is still the case. Now, the humanity that is now part of Godhead in the person of Jesus is a transformed version of humanity. But the point is that Jesus still has a physical body, but he changed what physical means in the process of the resurrection.
was true when he was here on earth, it is still true today. Humanity, or at least a transferred version of it, is now part of God in heaven. And that is quite something to think about. All the ramifications that come from that. You know, that was probably one of the most powerful things I learned in my 4 years of seminary. I don't think I've ever thought of that issue before. You know, what it says is that God has chosen to cast his lot with us forever. It means we will never be abandoned by our God. That humanity is so precious to him, it is now part of him. But there's more. The human body is meant to be sacred, especially since we believe that God lives within us when we are in a state of grace. So we should take care of our bodies. They are destined for eternity, and not just our spirit. Now, how do we know this? Well, we say the creed every week, and we will again today. We believe in the resurrection of the body. It got changed to the resurrection of the dead, but same difference. Now, the reason our bodies will be raised up is to be rejoined with our souls, making us whole once again. Our transformed, resurrected bodies and souls will be rejoined at the end of the time, not annihilated. And this has consequences in the area of morality. So what we do with our bodies has its effect on the eternity that we will experience. There is a continuity that exists between our life here and our afterlife. And just as an example of this, to think about in your own life, would you say that the day you got married changed your life immensely? Yes, and yet you remain who you are as a person. Both of those things happen at the same time. I think the afterlife will be the same sort of thing, with death being the transition point. Yes, something will be very different in our experience of life, but we will still remain the same people we were here. And that means that there is going to be some continuity between our life now and our life after death. Well, if that's true, wouldn't it make sense then that we would begin to experience a little bit of what our eternity will be like, even in this world? Maybe you've had a little bit of an experience of heaven during a particular experience of prayer, or at the birth of one of your children, or something monumental like that. Well, that's a little experience of heaven. And it's a foretaste of what is to come. On the other hand, if you're a mean, rotten person your entire life, I'm guessing that your experience of this life will not be very good, just as a consequence of being a mean, rotten person. Mean, rotten people tend not to have any friends, for one thing, and so they tend to be lonely people, and that makes them miserable. Well, in the next life, also as a consequence, it could quite possibly be even worse. I hope you can see that everything I have said demolishes the notion of dualism. If dualism were true, then we really shouldn't care that much about the physical needs of our brothers and sisters who are in need. And yet, we know that Jesus told us that we must attend even to their bodily needs when that is necessary. If dualism were true, we wouldn't need to try to take care of the beautiful creation that God has given to us so that it will remain beautiful and capable of sustaining life generations from now. And yet we hear in the scriptures that God asks us as human beings to be stewards, caretakers of the creation he gave us. If dualism were true, and all these physical is bad, then there is no way that Jesus Christ, the second person of the Trinity, could come down here today at this Mass and be physically fed to us in the Eucharist. Jesus shows us today that he didn't come down to earth to like put on some kind of plane for us and then go back to the comfort of the Godhead and hope that we somehow got the point of his appearance. No, what the ascension says is he married us. Our human nature is a part of him now. At the end of today's gospel, it says, "And behold, I am with you always until the end of the age." In other words, the Lord said that he would be with us in this physical world. The very place that dualism says that God does not go home. And yet, there is his promise to us to be with us here and now until the end. Let us stand up and together confess our faith. I believe in one God, the Father of all men, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, of God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten.
Church, and we continue to carry on the mission Christ gave to his first disciples, preaching, teaching, and baptizing throughout all nations. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
And all nations lay down their arms and resolve never again to use instruments of death to resolve disagreements and discord. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who suffer,
Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received the bread you offered. Through the earth and work of human hands, it will become parts of the bread of life. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received the wine we offer. Fruit of the vine and work of human hands, it will become our spiritual drink. Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
On the day before he was to suffer, he took bread and
sacrifice all of you and eat it. For this is my body, which will be given for you. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took this precious chalice in his holy and venerable hands, and once more giving thanks, he said the blessing and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory."
Thank you.
peace of the Lord be with you all. Let us offer each other the same peace.
Saint Michael, we are ready.
We are attached against the witness, spirits of the devil. And you are the beginning of the end. And you will present the heavenly hosts by the divine power of the Father, saving all the other people's spirits, who are in the world, saving the human souls.
Well, obviously, there will not be coffee and donuts in the East Wing until the restrictions are lifted. And also, we cannot pass the collection plate, but like I said, at the beginning. But we welcome visitors and hope you will return when things are back to normal. And finally, somebody pointed out to me that an English historian who's a Catholic has just written a book called Catholicism in the Time of Coronavirus. And it is available for free online at Bishop Robert Barron's website, wordonfire.org. So it's free. And he gives there a history of what the Church has done during the times, the many times that she has gone through pandemics and the plague in Europe. And explains how Catholics dealt with it at that time. And I think he even has some suggestions for us today. But it's free, and it's like a big print for those who are optically challenged. And his name is Dr. Stephen Olivet. Oh, yes. Also, those of you who signed petition 120 a while back, we had a prisoner collect those signatures. Apparently, they didn't make it to where they needed to go, or they got rejected, I'm not sure. But we have another gentleman here today who will again be taking signatures. And since none of Herc's got on, if you signed it before, you can sign it again, because it doesn't sound like those other ones got it. So you'll be back awaiting your signature. Let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, who allow those on earth to celebrate the divine mysteries, grant you, pray, that Christian hope may draw us onward to where our nature is united with you, through Christ our Lord.